Good morning, and welcome to New Hanover County Schools' The Morning Show. I'm Bradley Meadows.
And I'm Milo Kenny. This is the week of February 17th through the 23rd. Thank you for joining us today and starting your day off with our exciting and outstanding morning show.
We hope you are enjoying our show this year, along with our sister show, Your School News.
Before we get started today, we wanted to tell you about the many ways you can watch our channel and enjoy our quality programming.
As always, you can watch us on Spectrum Cable. We are Channel 5 in Wilmington and 191 at Carolina Beach.
Anyone with a Roku device can now watch our channel. Just add the free peg.tv channel, then find the blue NHCS TV logo under their educational channels line.
If you have Apple TV, just search for the NHCS TV channel. It's a free channel you can add.
And if you have no cable, Roku device, or Apple TV, you can watch our live stream online or on your iPad or cell phone.
Just go to nhcstv.wordpress.com. You'll see the live stream link.
You can also follow us on Twitter at NHCSTV and friend us on Facebook. Look for New Hanover County Schools TV.
You can also watch many of our shows and live events on our YouTube page. Just look for user NHC Schools.
So many great ways to watch and stay connected with NHCS TV.
And if you have been a viewer of our channel over the years, you might have noticed a change during the afternoon hours when we air our Your School News, as well as an addition between programming.
That's right. We have added a local weather segment between programming, and during When Your School News airs, we've added local weather, the NHCS and NHCS TV Twitter feeds as well.
Be sure to tune in to Your School News this afternoon and see all the changes. It airs most weekdays from 3 p.m. until 7 p.m.
It's time to check in with a third member of our team, Rocco Salerno. He is standing by right now with our first look at the morning news headlines. Good morning, Rocco.
Good morning, Bradley and Milo, and welcome everyone to Your School News here on The Morning Show. Topping the headlines this week, students get a close look at history with Tar Heels Go Walking Tour, Wynn Quinnett visits county schools holding workshops and performing, and students at Forest Hill celebrate Chinese New Year with a parade. I will have all those stories and more coming up later on the show.
Thanks, Rocco.
It's time for a staple here on The Morning Show, This Week in History. Our Grandmaster of Historical Knowledge has all the headlines from the past times and this week in history.
Welcome to This Week in History, covering all the colorful and amazing events that have left their mark on history's timeline. This is the week of February 17th through February 23rd. February 17th, 1972, the Volkswagen Beetle breaks the world car production record held for more than four decades by the Ford Motor Company's iconic Model T. Over 15,007,000 Beetles were sold to break the record. February the 18th, 1885, Mark Twain publishes his famous and controversial novel, The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. Twain saw Huck's story as a sequel to his earlier book, The Adventures of Tom Sawyer. February 19, 1473, Nicholas Copernicus is born in Turin, a city in north-central Poland. The father of modern astronomy, he was the first modern European scientist to propose that Earth and other planets revolve around the sun. February 20, 1792, President George Washington signs the Postal Service Act, guaranteeing inexpensive delivery of all newspapers, stipulating the right to privacy and granting Congress the ability to expand postal service to new areas of the nation. February 21, 1848, the Communist Manifesto written by Karl Marx is published in London. The political pamphlet, arguably the most influential in history, proclaimed that the inevitable victory of the working class would put an end to class society forever. Finally, your weekend history tidbits. February 22, 1980, in one of the most dramatic upsets in Olympic history, the underdog U.S. hockey team made up of college players defeats the four-time defending gold medal-winning Soviet team. It would be known as the Miracle on Ice. February 23, 1954, the first injections of the new polio vaccine developed by Dr. Jonas Salk is given. Over the next few years, the number of polio cases dropped from over 38,000 to under 1,000. That's This Week in History, your ultimate source for those key moments in time. Thanks for stopping by.
And join us again next time for another journey through time as we explore the fun, fascinating, entertaining, and educational facts that make up This Week in History.
We have plenty more of The Morning Show ahead, including an NHCS staff spotlight.
But first, as we head to break, we have the word of the week. Each week, we highlight an advanced English word, so when you use them in a sentence, you can impress even educated speakers. Here's our word of the week.
Kevin, you thinking about retirement?
I'd love to, but I'm pretty busy with all this.
Yeah. Hey, let's meet our retirement coach, Avo. A is for taking action.
Not anxiety?
No, Kevin, you're gonna be fine.
You sing?
Barely. V is for variety.
And you dance?
Sort of. Come on. O is for optimize your savings.
Let Avo lead the way.
Visit aceyourretirement.org today.
Nice.
Thanks.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. I'm Bradley Meadows.
And I'm Milo Kenny.
It's time for Snapshots, where we take quick looks at some of the positive things going on around our school system.
From fun projects to school-wide events to guest speakers and fabulous field trips, there are so many great things for our schools to celebrate.
Brandon Big B Hickman from Coast 97.3 visited Coddington Elementary to speak with students about poetry and hip-hop as a part of their Black History Month celebration. Students had a fun time learning from their guest, who is also the host of NHCS TV's Sports Roundtable.
Pine Valley Elementary celebrated World Read Aloud Day with special reading throughout the school. Teachers and students were joined by guest readers in this day-long celebration.
Roland Grice's Knights Ultimate Frisbee team traveled to the Middle School States Championship in Chapel Hill. Congratulations to the Knights for coming in third in their division.
Students and their art teachers in the district visited the UNCW printmaking studios to learn about printmaking techniques and experience the college visual arts department.
NHCS celebrated School Bus Driver Appreciation Week. Students and staff from across the district made signs and took a moment to thank their bus drivers.
Football season may be over, but Ashley High School football players continued their partnership with the students at Anderson Elementary. It's all a part of the Big Brother program between the two schools.
Laney SDA students run a coffee shop at the school called Buck a Cup. Some of their most loyal customers are the school's SROs. Other students and faculty also enjoy the warm cup of joe they serve.
Alderman kindergartners enjoy mixing paint to create new colors as part of a fun art project. The young students also enjoyed learning how to darken and lighten colors by mixing.
And that's this month's snapshots, our quick looks at some of the positive things going on around our school system.
This Valentine's Day, be sure to reach out those special people in your life and celebrate it with them.
It's time now for our morning news. Let's send it over to Rocco Salerno, who has several great stories to report. Good morning, Rocco.
Thank you, and welcome to Your School News in the Morning Show. I'm Rocco Salerno. Our top story this week, students recently got an up-close look at history with the Tar Heel Go Walking program. Third graders took a long walk through downtown Wilmington with stops at the Wilmington Fire Station headquarters, historic Thalian Hall, and several other notable landmarks. This year's tour guide also brought chalk along to make important notes on the sidewalk, helping the students visualize and feel engaged in what they are learning. Tar Heel Go Walking is a partnership between the Historic Wilmington Foundation and New Hanover County Schools. This is the 12th season for the event that brings our students from around the country.
I think the children need to be exposed to real life history, and there's no better way to do it than taking a good walk through the wonderful city of Wilmington.
For nearly a decade, tour guides like Mary Lou Cook have helped educate more than 22,000 children about Wilmington's history.
We have so much history here. We are a very old city and much to offer, and we also have been fortunate that there's so many people in this area who have been committed to preservation, so that we do have opportunities for children to see what it looked like back in the day.
Wilmington Historic Foundation teams up with New Hanover County Schools for Tower Hills Go Walking, a program that started back in 2009. Kids get the chance to see history come alive by visiting several key places downtown.
Wilmington has an incredible history, both good and bad, and it's important for our students to have an introduction to that, and we want to carry this further as they go along into adulthood.
The kids love being out here. With Snipes students, it's very close to where they live, so they've been downtown maybe in different aspects to eat or to spend time with their family, but coming down and actually learning about the historical sites, the things that they're hearing about in the classroom really brings their neighborhood alive for them. They're hearing about historical figures and historical events, and then they're actually seeing where some of these things happened and what the buildings look like in those time periods just right here in their neighborhood. So it really gives them a chance to connect with it.
We all get to bond together and see all these old stuff here. So I really like it.
The Bellamy Mansion, Keenan Fountain, and Thalian Hall are just some of the stops along the way. Students say the experience really opens their eyes.
I learned that George Davis had a horse, and then he was really protective about this horse, so he let it stay in the church too with all the other soldiers.
I learned about some other people and other old houses that I never saw before.
The next day, they're always really reflective about it, about how awesome it was and how they'd walked by the fire department 100 times but had never really paid attention to the bell, or they had seen the Bellamy Mansion but they didn't understand, you know, when it was built and those kinds of things. And actually going in Thalian Hall and hearing that it wasn't always a performing arts center, that it served so many other things in their community.
It's a tour that even allows teachers to learn about things that they may not have known before.
I'm from North Carolina originally, but I'm not from Wilmington. So the first time going on this tour, it really opened up Wilmington for me, which then made it easier for me to open it up for my students because I understood it a little better myself. So just having this opportunity to get them out of the classroom and get them immersed in their own culture is a great addition to our curriculum.
Mary Lou is just glad she's able to share her knowledge with so many young students who are eager to learn.
It's such a pleasure to be able to volunteer with the Historic Wilmington Foundation and partner with the school system to do something like this. As someone who's retired, it gives me an opportunity to give back to the community, and I really do enjoy that.
Chamber Music Wilmington recently welcomed the Volante Winds Quintet from Indiana to Wilmington. As part of their trip, they came to visit Ashley High School's Minnie Evans Auditorium, where they performed and answered questions for Ashley Band and Murray Orchestra/Band students in the morning. Then they traveled to Myrtle Grove to do more hands-on workshop with the Myrtle Grove Band students in their classroom. Founded in 2016, Volante Winds was formed out of a desire to collaborate with inspiring and civil colleagues in the pursuit of excellence in chamber music performance. As doctoral candidates at the Jacobs School of Music in Indiana University, Volante Winds has a passion for pedagogy that shines through their recitals and master classes. A firm believer in the needs for citizen musicians who actively engage with their community, Volante Winds has sought out dynamic collaborations with local artists. As part of their mission to bring music to underserved areas, Volante Winds has performed for rural communities throughout the United States as well. New Hanover County Schools will hold its annual Magnet and Choice Schools Fair on Thursday, February 20th, 2020 from 5:30 p.m. to 7 p.m. at Independence Mall Center Court. The Magnet and Choice Fair is an opportunity for the district to share with parents and the community detailed information about programs and how to register students. Each school and invited community partner will have a table to promote their organization or their school or organization. The Magnet and Choice Schools Fair will provide information on the following topics: special programs, academic programs, gifted programs, student perspectives, staff perspectives, benefits, lottery process, where applicable, school calendars, and application timeline. All parents living in New Hanover County are welcome to attend. License will be available, as well as representatives from Student Support Services to answer any enrollment questions that parents may have. There will be entertainment and door prizes. The event is free to attend. Forest Hill Global Elementary celebrates the Chinese New Year in a big way each year by having a huge parade. YSN reporter Yahan Yellow is there and filled this report.
The second grade students at Forest Hills Elementary have been studying the Chinese culture these past few weeks. Their hard work and newfound knowledge culminated with a huge school-wide parade to honor the Chinese New Year. This year's Chinese New Year occurred on January 25th. A unique thing about the Chinese New Year is that every year has an assigned animal or branch. This year's animal is the rat, one of 12, the others being the rooster, ox, tiger, rabbit, dragon, snake, horse, goat, monkey, dog, and pig. Forest Hills holds a Chinese New Year celebration each year to help students think about the world in a more global perspective and learn about other cultures.
Students have been really excited about learning about other places, and it's been awesome to see them apply their knowledge to things that they encounter in current events and like a geographic understanding of what we're doing. So it's been exciting for them to, you know, create things and get more engaged by doing the parade, but also to learn about the world from a geographic and personal perspective.
For the parade, each second grader created their own mask and streamers. Many of them also dressed in red, which symbolizes good luck. Other students at the school lined the hallways and cheered wildly as the parade went by.
There was a popsicle stick you hold, and then there was a dragon mask over it.
Why was it a dragon?
Yeah.
Because we were celebrating the dragon and the rat.
I like learning about it and studying different continents.
Why did you wear red today?
Because it was Chinese New Year this Friday.
And what does red symbolize?
The dragon. It's a lucky color.
The Chinese New Year celebration was a great success at Forest Hills. Because of the school's global focus, other grade levels learn about different regions of the world. In fact, the fourth graders just finished an Australia Day celebration. The students at Forest Hills Global Elementary are really getting a wonderful perspective of the world we live in. Reporting for Your School News, this is Johan Yellow.
For all the latest on New Hanover County Schools, join us weekdays at 5 p.m. here on Spectrum Cable Channel 5 and Channel 191 in Carolina Beach for Your School News. A complete half hour of all the latest news and information from New Hanover County Schools. Now back to our hosts.
Thanks, Rocco.
All right, it's time now for this week's lunch menu. This is the menu for Monday, February 17th through Monday, February 24th.
On Monday, February 17th, shake off those Monday morning blues at lunch with chicken wings and a garlic knot, a lasagna roll-up, or an appetizing barbecue riblet sandwich. Stay healthy by enjoying broccoli with cheese, a tomato and cucumber salad, and delicious diced peaches.
Then, on Tuesday, February 18th, race to the nearest lunch line and grab exciting nacho grande with cheese sauce, corn dog nuggets, or a pork chop sandwich. And on your way to the table, be sure to grab pinto beans, exciting sweet potato fries, and diced pears.
On Wednesday, February 19th, get over that old midweek hump by treating yourself to fantastic orange chicken with brown rice, cheesy breadsticks with marinara sauce, or a tasty Philly cheesesteak. As if that's not good enough alone, you can add succulent succotash and amazing applesauce to your plate.
On Thursday, February 20th, battle your midday hunger by enjoying either a beefaroni with breadstick, a Chick-fil-A sandwich, or cheese or pepperoni pizza. Along with those tasty treats, enjoy healthy black-eyed peas, golden glazed carrots, and marvelous mandarin oranges.
Then, on Friday, February 21st, enjoy a healthy lunch at home as there's no school. It is a designated teacher workday.
Finally, on Monday, February 24th, how will you ever decide between enticing chicken Alfredo with a dinner roll, a flavorful Italian hoagie, or barbecue pork with hush puppies? Side items include coleslaw, fresh garden peas, tomato and cucumber salad, and diced peaches.
And there you have the lunch menu for the week. In addition to those items, milk, a garden salad, fresh fruit, French bread pizza, and a peanut butter and jelly combo will be available daily.
So many delicious choices. Don't forget, you can also start your day off with a healthy and hearty breakfast at school.
Now, when we come back, we have a great segment spotlighting NHCS staff members.
It's coming up right after this short break.
Your son wants to get a cat, but you're allergic. Do you A, prepare yourself, B, make the best of it,
C squared equals 25.
Good job!
Or C, find a loophole. When it comes to parenting, there are no perfect answers, but that's okay, because you don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Teens in foster care will love you just the same.
Jeff Foxworthy here. You know, if you've ever found yourself repeating the same thing for 75 years, you might be Smokey Bear.
Only you can prevent wildfires.
Well, thing is, there's a lot more to say. Like if you've ever found yourself burning yard debris and then walking away, well, you might be starting a wildfire. So for the love of the outdoors, go to SmokeyBear.com to learn more about wildfire prevention.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. I'm Bradley Meadows.
And I'm Milo Kenny.
We're also thrilled to continue today's show with an episode of NHCS Spotlight. This segment introduces us to people who work behind the scenes for New Hanover County Schools. We will meet them, get to know a little about their job, and how they support our school system.
Today we meet Valjean Estes, an energy manager for the school system. We learn about her role and how she supports our schools and the people in our schools.
As energy manager, my job is to look at how we use our energy and see where there are opportunities to save energy and save money while we keep the buildings and facilities safe and comfortable. So that means I, on a monthly basis, enter all our billing information. I also audit the buildings outside of the occupied hours to see if there's equipment that's running, try to find out why it is, if it should be, because ideally we just want to maximize the equipment that we have so it's running properly when people are occupying the building and that it's set back during unoccupied times. I first became aware of, the school's energy program by reading about it in the newspaper. I read about how much energy and money was saved during that first year of the energy program, and I was really excited. So I contacted the company that the school system had a contract with to see what opportunities they had for energy managers. And at the time, they didn't have any opportunities for an energy manager, but they wanted somebody to come on to sell the program, you know, them going into schools and saving money. So I did that for about 9 months, and you would not believe how difficult it is to convince a school to save money through their energy program. But when the energy manager left, I interviewed for that position and started the job in October of 2013. I would say changing behavior, because what we want to do is get everybody on board with doing what they can in whatever facility they're in to save energy. So a part of what I'm doing with communicating about the energy program is sending out those monthly emails to make people aware of the program, what we're doing, the things we need to do in the classrooms and the schools to save money. So when I audit, I'm looking to see how well we're doing. And oftentimes I find, you know, equipment on or blinds not closed, and just the changing of the behavior to make people aware, to continue to be vigilant about doing those things that we can to save energy and save money. I think it helps us all to be good stewards of the resources that we have. Again, what we're trying to do is be a good steward of our planet by saving energy, but also being a good steward of our tax dollars by using them where they are needed. If we've got inefficiencies, we want to tighten up on that so we can use that saved money for other areas of need. So I think we've done a great job by saving energy, lessening our carbon footprint, saving our planet, but also saving money so we can use it more for the classrooms. The favorite part of my job is working with the kids. because they're fun and they're funny and they're motivating. I get to work with things like this wind turbine and just get motivated by their interest in learning new things.
Thank you, Mrs. Estes, for all you do for New Hanover County Schools, the students, and the employees.
And all year long, here on The Morning Show, we will feature staff and student highlights and special features, so be sure to tune in each week.
Our next segment is College Bound 411. College Bound 411 is dedicated to helping students achieve their dream of attending college. We provide practical and timely information for students so they can compete effectively for college admission. We also clue you in on the latest in scholarship information, so get out that pen and paper.
Have you recently applied or have been accepted into your dream school? Are those tuition fees looking a little too costly? Well, before you go worrying, go looking for scholarships to help pave the way. To get you started, here are three scholarships that can ease the college financial burden. Our first scholarship is titled Inspire Our Future Scholarship. This is a $500 scholarship and the requirements are as follows. You must be currently enrolled in a degree-seeking undergraduate program of study as a sophomore, junior, or senior, or a graduate student at a post-secondary institution. You must also be in good academic standing with a grade point average, or GPA, of 3.5 or higher on a 4.0 scale. Finally, you must be majoring in one of the following degree programs: child development, early childhood education, education, educational administration, secondary education, or special education. The deadline for this scholarship is April 1st. For more information, please visit teacher.org/scholarships-grant. Our next scholarship is the North Carolina Hospitality Education Foundation Graduate Student Scholarship. This is for students pursuing a course of study in culinary arts, hospitality management, or tourism. The scholarship awards $750 to $1,500, but you must be a North Carolina resident to apply. Applications are due March 15th. For more information, visit ncrla.org. And our final scholarship to get you going is the North Carolina Business and Professional Women's Foundation Scholarship. This scholarship awards up to $1,500. Requirements for this scholarship are as follows. You must be a female with a 2.5 GPA or higher. You must also be currently enrolled, full or part-time, at an accredited community college, college, or university. You must also be a North Carolina resident. The deadline for this scholarship is April 15th. For more information, visit bpw-nc.wildapricot.org. As you can see, not every scholarship is about having the highest GPA or grade point average. Many are based on your college focus and your background. We encourage all college-bound students to take time to search and apply for scholarships relevant to them. That's all for now. Good luck on your college scholarship search.
If you are college bound, be sure to communicate with your counselors and potential colleges to confirm specific dates for application deadlines, as well as course requirements.
And remember not to wait too long to apply. Deadlines come quicker than you think, and it's best to be ahead of the curve.
Now we head to break with our new modern music bumper. Enjoy these quick looks and listens of the musicians of our time.
Hi, I'm Ice-T. As a veteran, I know that for many former servicemen and women, the battle doesn't always end when they come home. Every day, 184 veterans are diagnosed with post-traumatic stress, and sadly, 20 take their own lives. When nothing else helps, professionally trained service dogs can. American Humane, serving the U.S. military for over 100 years, rescues animals in need of forever homes, and trains them to become free, life-saving service dogs for our nation's veterans. If you're a veteran or know a veteran struggling with post-traumatic stress or traumatic brain injury, please go to AmericanHumane.org to learn about their Pups for Patriots program. Let's give our veterans a fighting chance.
Good morning and welcome back to The Morning Show. I'm Milo Kenny.
And I'm Bradley Meadows.
We have some great segments ahead, but first we have our Did You Know?
Did you know that the world's spiciest pepper could kill you if you eat too much?
Yep, the ghost pepper is rich in capsaicin, which is a neurotoxin that causes seizures, heart attacks, and death.
In fact, a study from 1980 found an individual weighing 150 pounds would only have to eat 3 pounds of the pepper in order to be killed.
While you may think that the pepper may make your food more delicious, your body will likely disagree because it has evolved to view capsaicin as a harmful substance.
This is why your nose runs or eyes water when you eat a spicy food. Your body is trying to flush it out of your system.
While capsaicin may be fatal in high quantities, peppers that are rich in it have been known to help relieve pain related to arthritis.
In addition to this, many peppers are high in phytonutrients, which helps to lower cholesterol, blood pressure, and a person's risk of heart disease. Many dietitians recommend eating a variety of different types of colors of hot peppers to get the most benefits.
However, pepper's spicy quality does more than help humans. Researchers at Cornell University found that the toxins which give the peppers their kick can prevent them from growing foodborne bacteria and fungi, which means they can stay fresher for longer periods of time. In other words, the spicier, the better.
That's all of our facts about peppers. We hope they spiced up your day.
Now we bring you a new and interesting segment of Science Nation from the National Science Foundation.
They take us to California and a winery of all places where scientists are testing a new way to turn wastewater into clean water and energy at the same time.
It is hoped this new system will revolutionize how much energy is used in cleaning industrial wastewater.
Do you enjoy an occasional sip of the grape? Bet you didn't know that on average it takes 5 to 7 gallons of water to make one bottle of wine, and water is a pricey commodity. Cleaning and recycling all the wastewater is no bargain either. Wineries typically use aeration pumps, which drink up tons of energy and profits.
They're spending hundreds of thousands of dollars every year just to power the pumps to push air through their wastewater to treat it.
The Clos de Bois Winery in Sonoma, California wants to reverse that trend and is testing a new system that not only cleans the water, but generates energy too.
And we're leading the efforts to be commercializing this and getting it deployed at a commercial scale for industrial customers.
With support from the National Science Foundation, engineers and co-founders Matt Silver and Justin Buck at Cambrian Innovation are bringing this research from the lab to the market. One system, called EcoVolt, generates methane gas from the wastewater.
EcoVolt leverages what's called electromethanogenesis.
Here's how it works. A wireless signal allows the process to be monitored remotely. The Cambrian system sends wastewater through what's called a bioelectrochemical reactor. As water filters through it, special bacteria in the reactor eat the organic waste in the water and release electrons as a byproduct. Those electrons travel through a circuit to generate methane, or CH4.
We're actually generating very high quality methane, which can be used to power what's called a combined heat and power system.
The gas is piped out of the system to an engine, where it's burned with a small amount of natural gas to generate heat and electricity for the vineyard.
It helped us realize that wastewater is a potential source of energy, and using the right treatment methods with minimal energy input, we can receive quite a bit of benefit.
Overall, we have a huge reduction in the carbon footprint for the winery, as well as savings of upwards of over $200,000 a year.
Sensor systems built by Cambrian Innovation can also monitor pollutant levels in real time, fertilizer runoff, for example, or pollution levels in lakes and rivers.
The goal would be to monitor and to be able to identify if a spike in a contaminant has occurred and to try to address it before it becomes a larger problem.
Silver expects many industries to benefit from systems like the EcoVolt, from fisheries to wastewater treatment plants, making water that was once wasted into a valuable source of energy. For Science Nation, I'm Miles O'Brien.
We hope you enjoyed that interesting story from the National Science Foundation.
Every time I see an episode of Science Nation, I'm amazed by the things being invented.
Hopefully, with advances like these and a change in how much waste we generate, we'll be able to make the planet's resources permanently sustainable.
Let's hope so. Now, for our next segment, even though it's winter and cooler outside, it's still a good time to enjoy nature. Our friends from the Cape Fear Garden Club continue to provide us with wonderful information and tips in their segment, Gardening in Nature. In today's episode, host Barbara Downing continues her looks at the Venus flytrap during her visit to the Stanley Reeder Carnivorous Plant Garden.
Good morning. This morning we're here at the Stanley Reeder Carnivorous Plant Garden, and I am joined here at Gardening in Nature by Jessica Blake, Director of Stewardship and Community Conservation for the North Carolina Coastal Land Trust. But a Venus flytrap isn't the only plant, though, that gets nourishment from insects.
Right. There's a whole different group of carnivorous plants, and there's five different trapping mechanisms. This is obviously called the snap trap because it's going to snap and close. But we have, in this garden right here, we also have pitcher plants, and that's a pitfall trap. So basically, it is what it sounds like. It falls in and can't get out, but all of the different types of carnivorous plants have the digestive enzymes that they release and are able to digest the nutrients and absorb it.
Okay. So after it has this eaten, and you said for about a week,
it's going to stay closed for about a week. It'll open back up. The traps don't live forever. It only can happen a couple of different times, and then that trap, because it's a leaf, will fall off. But the fly trap will have other leaves growing throughout the year, other traps there. Another adaptation that the fly traps have is winter dormancy. So they are able to go dormant over winter. They kind of look dead. People do call me all the time. They're like, oh no, the fly traps are dead here. I'm like, no, it's winter. They're just dormant. And they'll come back up in the spring.
Okay. And they say they flower. Is that around in May?
Right, right. We have a fly trap frolic out here every April. And a lot of times we're really lucky to have the flowers just starting. So the end of April to the beginning of June is usually the window based on what the spring's been like.
And so it's from pictures I've seen, I don't know if I have one in here, but it has a white flower.
Yes, yes, a beautiful white flower. And another fun adaptation that we talk about in the classroom is that the flower, like most carnivorous plants, comes much higher, so that if the flytrap is growing here, the flower's here. And the reason for that is that it's depending on your pollinators, and you don't want to eat your pollinators. So if the bee lands on here, it's going to go to another flower. If they were closer together, it probably would eat its pollinator, and it's not helpful in its reproduction.
Ah, makes sense.
Uh-huh.
It's such a smart...
This is a very well-designed plant.
Nature is so efficient. So in terms of getting back to this word poaching, I know something horrendous happened here a couple of years ago.
Right.
They lost 1,000.
1,500.
1,500. Mm-hmm. And they could just, nobody saw it. Technically this land belongs to the city. This is a city park.
Almost. It's a very strange partnership we have here. This land is actually still privately owned, and we have an easement on it, so that was the protection aspect of it. But our easement was crafted very nicely to allow us to lease the property for environmental education and public use, as long as it respected the conservation values. So we leased it to the city. So our partnership with the landowner and the city and the Coastal Land Trust has allowed this to just be shared with the public, and it's been really nice.
Oh, great. Well, that poaching and took out 1,500 plants. I mean, that would be a tremendous thing. But did they not install then? Are there not cameras?
Yes, there are. There are cameras, but it was also the poaching here was a big instigator in the trying to push forward new legislation to make poaching a flytrap a felony. And that legislation did get passed, so it is a felony to poach a flytrap.
Right, I think Ted Davis, right. One of our local representatives, state representatives, was responsible for.
Yes, he was the champion for that legislation.
Yes, and so that's what, in terms of what you're talking about, poaching. And the sad part is when they poach the plants, they don't get more than like 20 cents or something on them.
The market varies, but it's still not good enough. It's not good enough for something so rare and threatened and something so special to us here in Wilmington. I mean, if it only grows here, mm-hmm. we really embrace that. It's our plant.
Right.
And it poaching, fire suppression, and development are the three things that are really making this place, this plant, not be able to thrive. You know, it's at risk, and so poaching is very, very devastating.
Now, if somebody truly wanted a Venus flytrap, they can be purchased.
They can, yes. There are very good places to purchase them. A lot of them are actually created through cloning, and so it's not robbing the wild of the plants that grow there, but just sort of supplementing human desire to have one. They're also kind of hard to take care of. So I know a lot of people that go and get them at places and mm-hmm. they'll call and be like, I don't know why it's not alive.
Yeah, I think you'd have to have patience to catch the flies to do that. So in other words, the garden centers around town don't buy from the poachers.
Correct.
That's just not
right. That was a side effect of the legislation as well, is that, you know, there's more knowledge about how special this is and the right way to do things. And so there are vendors that sell them that are making sure they're not getting them from poachers.
Right. Now, and you said it does come from a bulb?
A bulb, yeah. It has a bulb underground. And that is what makes it so fire welcome. The bulb structure sort of protects the plant from the fire. So you could burn this whole area, like they would burn Halliburton, and obviously the leaves would burn off and it would just be, you know, charcoaly looking. But because the bulb survived, it gives it sort of a head start over the other plants. Mm-hmm. And so they have a head start in shooting out new leaves, and they green up first and can outcompete what's happening. So it basically gives them a foot forward.
Oh, great. Thank you so much for coming out on this kind of, it's not very humid.
It's, no, it's not.
It's not as bad as it could be.
Right, so. Right.
And plus we have some shade here, so yes. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you for having us. We really appreciate it.
All right, great. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Miss Downing.
That was a great look at the Venus flytrap. Be sure to tune in all year long for more segments of gardening and nature, including a look at the pollinator gardens and how to properly plant a tree.
Okay, everyone, get your thinking caps ready, because when we come back from break, it's game time.
What challenging trivia game awaits today?
Keep it tuned here to find out.
We'll be right back.
Support the Feeding America nationwide network of food banks to help provide meals to those in need. Join us at feedingamerica.org.
Welcome to Game Time. I'm your host, Rocco Salerno. Here at Game Time, we pit two contestants head-to-head in a themed and educational contest. Fear not, though, because you at home get to test your knowledge alongside our contestants. Let's meet our contestants and learn a little bit about our theme. Welcome to Game Time, Bradley and Milo.
It's one of America's favorite foods, the go-to meal at parties, and the perfect meal for the family when you don't feel like cooking.
It's pizza, and we all know it and love it.
However, how much about pizza do you actually know? To fill you in a bit, this delicious food's history, and share all the fun pizza facts, we have a special segment for you this morning.
So sit back and get ready to learn all about pizza.
Pizza is a truly international food with over 5 billion sold worldwide each year. Nowadays, people of all classes and social status eat pizza. However, when pizza originated in 997 AD, it was strictly a peasant's food. It wasn't until the late 18th century, when the royalty of the time began eating pizza, that its popularity began to rise. As its popularity among the wealthy grew, street vendors began to open up storefronts and pizzerias were here to stay. Pizza didn't start out looking like we know it today. Pizza existed for over 500 years before tomatoes were added to it, and it was actually the first Italian food to use tomatoes. For centuries, tomatoes were thought to be poisonous, but during a trying time, the citizens of Naples had run out of other foods and were forced to eat them. When they realized the delicious food was not toxic, they began to use tomato sauce on everything, and the modern pizza was born. These days, along with the crust, tomato sauce, and cheese, there are dozens of toppings sold regularly, and nearly every food has been tried as a topping at least once. Pizza types can now be differentiated by the size of the crust, the amount of toppings, and the way it is cooked, and the types of toppings on the pizza. One of the biggest differences in pizzas in America is between the Chicago deep dish style and the New York thin crust. The Chicago deep dish pizza was designed to have more food on the plate and to be eaten as a meal. The New York style, on the other hand, was designed to be a portable snack. In America, New York style thin crust is preferred, with 61% of the people preferring it over the Chicago deep dish. Along with all the different types of toppings and crust, many different cheeses are used on pizza. Mozzarella is the most common, found on 60% of pizzas, and there's a reason for it. Mozzarella has the best baking property of the cheeses, having high moisture and low quantities of free oil. Here are a few fun pizza tidbits from around the world. In Italy, they take their pizza serious. So serious, in fact, that there's a bill before Parliament to ensure pizza maintains a certain quality, making it illegal to call an improperly prepared pizza a traditional Italian pizza. The largest pizza ever made was in South Africa. The pizza measured 37.4 meters in diameter and weighed almost 27,000 pounds. It had 1,100 pounds of flour, 1,750 pounds of cheese, and 2,000 pounds of tomatoes. Every year, the International Pizza Expo is held in Las Vegas. At the show, pizza connoisseurs from all over the world meet to share their trade secrets and see the newest secrets in the world of pizza. The expo is closed to the public, so only pizza professionals can see the secrets. There's the fun facts and brief history of pizza. From a peasant's food using a poisonous plant to one of the most eaten foods in the world, pizza is a defining food of our planet.
We hope you enjoyed our spectacular pizza special. It's time now to put that knowledge to the test.
I'm ready.
Okay, let's send it back over to Rocco, who will explain the rules and get us started.
Today, Bradley and Milo will compete in Spin the Pizza. They will compete to be first to score 5 points and win the title Pizza Champ, which includes bragging rights for a whole year. The game is simple. Our contestants take turns spinning the pizza wheel and answer a question from the category they land on. The categories are pizza question, multiple choice, true, false, and random. Random question. They may also land on a free point or lose their turn. Okay, Bradley, we get to spin the pizza wheel first.
All right, let's get it. Random question,
okay. Which land did Puff the Magic Dragon live on? A, Narnia, B, Hunley, or C, Oz?
B.
That is correct. You get one pizza point.
That's an interesting question.
Yeah. Okay. Milo?
Yep.
Let me spin.
Lose a turn.
Free point.
Free point.
It's rigged.
It's nice.
It's rigged.
That.
It's rigged.
I'm a natural.
Okay. Multiple choice.
Ooh. Okay. How many pizzas can the world's fastest pizza maker make in a minute? A, 3, B, 4, C, 5, or D, 6?
I'm going to go with 5, C, 5.
That is correct.
Make Let's
five
go.
Pizzas in a minute.
What? Okay. That's going to be true or false.
Got it. The largest pizza ever made was over 150 feet in diameter.
True.
That is false. The largest pizza was just over 120 feet in diameter.
All right.
You receive no pizza point.
No.
Three point.
No, lose a turn. Multiple choice.
That's multiple choice.
Okay. Yeah. What percentage of people consider pizza the perfect breakfast? A, 15%, B, 36%, C, 46%, or D, 55%?
Oh, I'm going to go with A, 15%.
That is false. It's actually 36%.
That's 30,
I was going to say
that's 36 too much. Okay.
Yeah.
True or false again?
Okay. The average slice of pizza has 350 calories.
No, that seems too much. 300, false.
That is correct. Actually, that's 285.
Okay.
True or false?
Okay. Squid is one of the most popular pizza toppings in Japan.
Ooh, in Japan. Oh, I don't even think, false? I don't know if they
Nope, that's true.
Eat pizza?
That's true. Japanese pizza. Okay, next.
Okay, yeah. Multiple choice.
Got it. Okay. What is the most popular pizza size in the U.S.? A, 14 inches, B, 16 inches, C, 18 inches, or D, 22 inches?
I wish I ate more pizza to know this. I'm going to say 18 inches.
That is incorrect. It's actually 14.
What?
Yeah. Pizza question.
Okay. What is the most popular night to eat pizza?
Friday.
That is false. It is Saturday.
Wow, come on.
Who? Multiple choice.
The average pizzeria uses how many pizza boxes each day? A, 20, B, 33, C, 47, or D, 55?
Average pizzeria. What was C, like 37?
C was 47.
47. I'll do 47 sounds pretty.
That is incorrect. It is actually 55 per day.
Lose a turn.
No!
Three points!
That's the opposite of what I wanted.
Three points.
Wow.
Okay. 3 points, right here.
Lose a turn.
I'll cry if it's lose a turn. Random question.
Random question. Okay. What is the metal or plastic end of a shoelace called? A, an aglet. B, the needle. Oh, okay, that is correct, yeah. Yes.
Phineas and Ferb.
Watch your Phineas and Ferb.
Lose a turn.
3 point again. Let's go.
Are you kidding me? This is rigged. Is there like 2 free points? Come on. Don't lose a turn. Okay, multiple choice. I can do
the this. Most expensive pizza costs A, $500, B, $750, C, $1,000, or D, $2,000.
I feel like it's over 1,000 because you can just put really expensive ingredients on it and then rise the price. I don't know if someone would go 2,000. That just seems a little too wild.
That is false. It's actually C. It is 1,000.
Ah.
Okay.
Yeah, free point.
Not a free point. If I lose on a free point.
Pizza question.
Pizza question.
Okay. What month is National Pizza Month?
It's February.
Nope, it's October.
Dang. So why are we playing a pizza game?
3 points. 3 points,
baby. No.
Please, oh, lose a turn. Please lose a turn.
3 points! Let's go! Three points!
Oh my god. Wow. That was intense. Alright. And the pizza champ for this year is Bradley. Congratulations.
Thanks. Good game, Milo.
Good game, Bradley.
Well, that does it for this edition of The Morning Show.
Please follow us on Twitter for all the latest and most up-to-date announcements at NHCS TV.
And you can watch our shows on demand on YouTube. Just search for NHCS Schools.
For the best TV of all, each and every day, keep it tuned right here for New Hanover County Schools TV on the Learning Network of the Cape Fear.
Have a great day.
And a wonderful week.